reason why Jarnell Stokes and Maimon may be the best 1-2 offensive rebounding combo that we have in the college game.
As they have the starting lineups being introduced at the Georgia Dome. Tennessee in their gray and orange. Florida in the white trimmed in orange and blue. And the starting lineups for Tennessee, also the Jumbotron for everybody here at the Georgia Dome. Three seniors, two juniors. Antonio Barton, Jordan McRae, Josh Richardson, Jaron Maimon, and Jarnell Stokes, who had a huge double-double again yesterday. For the number one team in the country, the Florida Gators, as you look through Doug Shile's head, you'll see part of it, and then you'll see four seniors. Scotty Wilbekin, Casey Prather, Will Youget, Patrick Young, and Michael Frazier, the sharpshooter, the sophomore. Speaking of shooting sharp, Shannon Spake is a third member of our team.
Well, Brad, Scotty Wilbekin admitted to me today that because there was so much pressure to remain undefeated in conference play, after they wrapped up their regular season last Saturday, the team took a deep breath and they relaxed a little bit. But they didn't relax for long. They came together as a group and they talked about what they needed to do moving forward to refocus. And Billy Donovan said that would be the biggest challenge, looking ahead, not looking back. And how's this for a visual reminder? Their SEC championship trophy, which they received yesterday, is still here in Atlanta. It's currently sitting in the hotel room on the floor of a manager of the team next to an ironing board. Scotty Wilbekin told me, Donovan said, let it be a reminder of everything you accomplished in the regular season, but also a reminder that you haven't won anything in the postseason yet.
Might also want to put that trophy by the ironing board because they have a very effective press. And we'll see that today against Tennessee.
On top of his game early, Brad Nessler.
Tennessee hasn't trailed in 200 minutes. Our officials, Joe Lindsay, Pat Adams, Doug Shouse, who you saw the back of his head, our lead official. Semifinal Saturday's underway. Here we go. And it's Antonio Barton at the point. Jaron Maimon had a big day yesterday on the boards. Stokes to Barton. They work it around the perimeter of McRae. A double-team Stokes down low. 10 to shoot. And he lost it off his foot.
You know what's coming, Billy Donovan. What does he do? He's always the aggressor defensively, Brad. And the first Stokes touch, they come with a monster action. He has three different ways to trap the ball off the block.
Three-time SEC Coach of the Year, including this year, when Florida basically swept the awards. Billy in his 18th season. Seems unreal if that's the case, but it is. Off the Frazier miss. Maimon with a rebound, and they'll leave it for McRae.
There's that long arm of the law that Jordan McRae can throw at Frazier and bother his shot with hand action around his head.
You're getting young every time one of the big guys for Tennessee gets it so far. They draw a double team.
Well, Tennessee laying the wood early for Florida in terms of how they're setting screens, setting the rules of how this game's going to be played on their end of the floor.
Wasn't a bad runner off the window, just didn't drop. Frazier on the outside. There's a double team on Youget. Now he comes out to set a screen. Patrick Young leaves it for Prather. 2-0 Florida.
Good hard cut by Prather. He's a score off of two bounces or less. And terrific patience by Patrick Young on the low block to wait on the cut.
So it was 201 minutes and 30 seconds that Tennessee has led in ball games. That's gone by the boards.
Can they play from behind? That's what we're getting ready to find out.
Two downs, not bad. McRae straight up with it on the baseline. Tie ball game.
I like what Conzo Martin does with Jordan McRae. Wilbekin's a terrific defender. McRae has about a 4-inch height advantage. Put him on that low block and let him go to work.
Youget flies in and got the roll.
Florida drives the ball this year off of their action. Over the past, they've thrown it inside off their action, or they've reversed the ball to three-point shots. This year, option 1A is drive the ball and make tough twos.
Florida, a little two-man backcourt pressure. Tennessee had no trouble with it. McRae around a pick. Jumper off the mark, and Prather's going to let it go out of bounds to Florida. Conzo Martin in his third year. And another 20-plus win season, 21 and 11 coming in.
Have they locked up an NCAA bid yesterday. Now a win today would move him from a 10 or 11 seed maybe up a line. That's what's at stake for Tennessee in this ball game.
Florida turns it over. They had some early turnover problems yesterday against Missouri. Nice drive inside by Maimon, and he draws a foul and one.
The play by Antonio Barton is crucial in this ball game for Tennessee. About 4 weeks ago, they made it mandatory 10 a.m. sessions with Antonio Barton with the coaching staff for about an hour, teaching him to be a point guard, play under control, teach the free throw line as a yield sign. It is not a stop sign. Treat the free throw line as a yield sign. Read the traffic. The traffic determines what you do with the basketball. Well done by Barton.
Well done by Maimon, who caps off the three-point play. And Tennessee has its first lead.
I would love to play against a point guard that treats the free throw line like a stop sign. He's guarding himself if he does.
Wilbekin will try a three. Wow. He lit it up yesterday, 5 for 6, and he starts the same way today.
How crucial is that three-point jump shot for Wilbekin this year? Another weapon to go along with Frazier. And that was one of the question marks on this Florida ball club about 6 weeks ago. Could they make enough threes? Scotty Wilbekin, what do you need, coach? I've got it in my back pocket.
They had enough yesterday. 12, in fact. 12 of 21 from three-point range. That's how they beat Missouri.
Billy Donovan, if his grandmother played on a basketball team, he would press her. That's who he is. You know, for the next 2 hours, Barton and McCray, Richardson, the press is going to come.
Stokes will try to drive. Puts it up on the run. Rebound comes off to Walker. Chris Walker in the lineup early today.
There you see the value of Walker. Just got eligible in February.
Scotty Wilbekin, a little heat check. And he checks right. Back-to-back shots. 5 points for Wilbekin. Martin's going to try to answer. We'll come all the way out to Maimon and a fresh shot clock for Tennessee.
Tennessee has to be terrific, Brad, when to punch and when to pull it back. And it's all in the hands of Barton for the most part on those decisions.
And we're going to have a foul on Florida. With 15:48 remaining in the first half. Scotty Wilbekin, who just picked up that foul, picked up the last 5 points for Florida, and they lead 9-5.
Plays the game with a great base and balance. Look at his feet. When he sticks that to go shoot, you could draw a straight line across his toes. Now, why is that important? Nothing done in basketball, off balance or off base, is done as well if you're not a strong base player. You watch Wilbekin play this game as a defender, strong wide base. As a checkoff guy on the defensive glass, he can take out a 6'10 kid because he plays with a strong wide base, and on offense, he can get into you. His hard to guard, three things that make him terrific.
Going it out of the zone as McCray trying to shoot him out of it. And the rebound kept alive by Moore. Molly Moore works baseline. Nice move. I think Finney Smith got a piece of it, but cleaning up is Jarnell Stokes, as he does so often.
Best set of paws in college basketball in traffic around the rim, Jarnell Stokes. Carves out space with his lower body, finishes off plays with velvet paws.
Yesterday, Jarnell, 22 points, 15 rebounds. Just another day at the office for him. His 19th double-double of the year. Wilbekin got his man in the air. And Florida works it down under the 10-second mark on the shot clock. Freddie Smith, hook pass. They're going to have to hurry. Frazier just had to throw it up there. It did hit the rim, but that's about it.
Good defensive discipline by McCray to not leave his feet. Got on his toes, but still the long arms of McCray bothering Frazier early.
That wasn't good awareness by Florida with the shot clock. Barton, nice drive.
Boy, Florida thrives off of driving the ball down the pipe. And normally defensively, they are so locked in on letting you do it. Barton that time goes downhill.
And Florida turns it over again. McCray with a steal and trying to go coast to coast. Does. Nice move by Jordan McCray.
his long arms as a defender and his ability to finish around the rim, Brad, in traffic. This is a 6'6 kid with a long wingspan on both ends of the floor.
Benny Smith gave up a three-pointer. Now Wilbekin will try two. He's 3 for 3.
Boy, sticking tough twos. That's a shot that goes in, I don't know, 26, 27% of the time. When you go back and grade all your films on the year as a coaching staff, Scotty Wilbekin hot early.
Good opening 6 minutes plus in him. And the Heat all starts with NBA Countdown presented by Speed Stick Gear at 3 o'clock. Great start here. Tied at 11 between the number 4 seed and the number 1 seed, Tennessee and Florida.
Florida's going to really try to light up Thompson, the slender freshman point guard on the floor right now. And he handled it.
Wow.
He did.
Handled the pass inside to Maimon beautifully. If that's not, it's not on Patrick Young, and that's good news for Florida. It's going to be on Finney Smith.
Yeah, just a little bit of help with Thompson to free him up off the pressure. But then the one thing that this Thompson kid has going for him against Florida is he is a legit 6'4 point guard that can make plays over the top of Hill and Wilbekin.
Tennessee's got in Stokes and Maimon guys that can muscle around with Patrick Young. In fact, they're both bigger as far as body weight, if you will. And the reason I said Patrick Young, you don't want to get your second foul. The second time these two teams played in the regular season, Patrick fouled out, but he doesn't foul out often. Stokes will sit now, so that takes away some of the big man power inside for Tennessee. And Patrick Young, the aforementioned, gets the rebound.
Yep. All man-to-man so far by Tennessee. They do have a 1-3-1 that they've gone through the last month. It's very effective because of their length.
Prater, that's his game. Too strong off the glass. Good rebound underneath by Derek Reese. Different looking lineup right now for the Volunteers, that's for sure.
Yeah, this is a grinded out offensive unit that Conzo Martin has on the floor.
Armani Moore. Kennesaw, Georgia native, knocks one down.
Remember yesterday, Florida had some trouble guarding the ball early in the first half against the big physical guards in Missouri. Starting to continue today so far.
Well, they had a little trouble with Brown, Clarkson, and Reese in that group. And a whistle on the inside. And the foul's going to be on Prater.
Tennessee's too good. They're too good defensively to try to drive the ball off the first side of the floor. And Florida's too experienced of a team to try to do it. Prather, a senior, bad decision. You got to get Tennessee moving side to side. Ball reversal for a driving team is at a premium. Billy Donovan didn't get it on that trip.
Josh Richardson, great job of holding his ground. Tennessee on a 9-2 push right now to lead by 3.
This time, the Florida pressure gets into Thompson. Didn't play low enough. Played too tall as a 6'4 point guard against the pressure. He's going to have to drop his waist in this ball game, or he'll have another turnover the next time he touches it.
That's his second here in the opening 7.5 minutes. Casey Hill right now playing the point for Florida. Patrick Young, he likes that spot with a hook shot. That one comes out. Maimon will clear it ahead to Richardson.
That is his range, though. He's increased his range every year up to about 8 feet with that jump hook. As a freshman, he's around the 4-foot mark, and that's it.
Both teams have starters waiting at the scorer's table. I don't think they're going to get in until we have a TV timeout, however, as we're under 12 minutes. As I said, both these lineups look a little different right now. Good drive inside. Richardson.
Tennessee prepared for the down or the ice action on the ball screen, forcing Tennessee to drive the ball towards the baseline. Conzo Martin says, we're fine with that. We will take our guard and attack your big. Very well done.
Well, the first time these two teams played, Tennessee only got 41 points in the game. They got 16 right now with 11:20 to play. Young got that one. Here comes the pressure, but no problem again. Maimon will wait for Richardson. Three-pointer, good.
Yeah, the ball movement is terrific so far for Tennessee, getting exactly what they want. Setting the ball screen, getting the throw back, and then the right pass, not the extra pass for the open shot.
And Casey Hill's going to go to the free throw line after the timeout. But Derek Reese hit that last three to give Tennessee its biggest lead so far in the first half. Number one team in the country struggling a little bit in the opening moments of game one of semifinal Saturday in Atlanta. All right, John, thanks. A surprising lead for Tennessee, up by six with 10:49 remaining in the first half.
That Tennessee very well prepared. Look what Ford is doing. They are down in the action right now, not letting this ball come this direction. As a result, hold it for a second, guys. Now it's one-on-one with Patrick Young with Richardson. And Richardson stays low. Patrick Young moves his feet well, but just not quite quick enough to stay up with Richardson. Good design play by Tennessee. You're going to force us to go baseline. We're going to draw our guy back and attack your big.
And with that, they've gone on a 14-4 run. And Florida points in the paint. Today they're on the minus side of things.
Well, why are they minus six today, points in the paint? Because Tennessee defensively, Brad, they build a wall. They pressure the ball, and they build a wall behind the ball pressure. Therefore, very difficult to get stuff around the rim.
Tennessee, they started off cold. They were 2-for-7. But they've hit their last six shots. Almost a midway point of a fast-paced first half and a five-point Tennessee lead.
That's the other thing that Maimon can do for you as the four-man. He can be the press breaker himself and bring it up against Jaguette or whoever they put on him.
He's been the press breaker virtually every time so far. Here's Stokes in the lane around Young. Maimon kept it alive and scored it.
I'm telling you, Tennessee shoots 61%, Brad, on offensive putbacks. 61%. Keep them off the glass.
File underneath as we check in with Shannon.
Well, Brad, Jimmy, I spoke with Scotty Wilbekin this morning, and I talked to him about some of the slow starts that this Florida team has experienced over this season. He could not explain why it happened, but he said the way that they pulled themselves out of it is they'll talk about it on the bench. They'll talk about the process, staying the course, and we have seen over and over again this season their ability to just kind of shake it off and move forward.
Good point. And a lot of that might hinge right now on Scotty Wilbekin being back in the lineup. He was on the bench when Tennessee went on a good majority of that run. And here he is with a kick out. Prather. Jumper's good.
Same thing on this end of the floor. Tennessee is down in the action on the side. Wilbekin reads it well, attacks the paint, and goes for the skip out. Scotty Wilbekin, to me, Brad, he owns it. He owns the game from the film session to the walkthrough to the pregame chalk talk to the game. Great point guards. They own the game, and Wilbekin owns the game.
Richardson got it down to Stokes, who threw a shoulder into Patrick Young. Not many people knock Patrick Young on his backside. That was a message sender.
It was a true blow. There was no fake fall by Young. He took one right on top of the Gator logo.
30 for 30, Requiem for the Big East explores the meteoric rise of the Big East Conference, becoming one of the most successful college sports leagues in America, but then eventually fighting for survival in a new era. 30 for 30, Requiem for the Big East, presented by Infinity. That's coming up on Sunday night at 9 on ESPN. Some of the snips of that, it's going to be a great show.
Martin did a good job of not letting Florida, Brad, force him into a speed dribble up the side. They get you on a speed dribble, that's when they really come at you. Barton had no part of it.
McCray, what a pass to Maimon, but he missed in close. Might have gotten a little too deep and lost how far he was under the basket. Three-pointer, Wilbekin, yes! He's 4-for-4. And as I said about Shannon's report, the complexity of the game changes when he's out there. McCray tried to duck a pass into Maimon. Tennessee turns it over.
Tennessee better slow this game down.
Prather!
Asking by Casey Prather. Timeout, Tennessee.
7-point lead evaporated to a deuce. 8:28 remaining. First half. Number one team in the country. Stakonzo Martin is kind of like a... I got him, you take him, Jimmy.
Yeah, well, McCray and Barton are going at one another right now, trying to work the thing out. Here's what I like about that. You can always hear a good team, and you can always hear a bad team. Tennessee's a good team. You can hear them right now trying to fix the problem before they even get into the hands of Konzo Martin. This is what sparked it. Patrick Young just buried Jarnell Stokes in front of the rim, got his big backside in front of Stokes and cleared out the path.
That was payback for the time he hit the deck down on the other end.
Yes.
Watching number four and number five go at it today is going to be fun.
Your description was terrific. Message sent by Jarnell Stokes to Patrick Young.
Again, some two-man pressure in the backcourt. Almost got to the ball. Frazier got a hand on it.
That Florida presses you the entire game, but they give you nothing. They give you nothing on the back end of the press. Discipline pressure from four seniors is what Billy Donovan has to work with.
And by the time you get your offense set, there's 20 or less on the clock, and now there's eight to shoot. Moore, fadeaway, way off the mark. Patrick Young saves it on the baseline.
Florida, they get that first ball screen on you in the first 3 or 4 seconds of the possession. The drag screen action. Billy Donovan uses the pro slot 45 pick and roll action. A lot of NBA tendencies in this Florida half-court offense.
They got Maimon on Wilbekin. He took the shot. He knew he had a mismatch in quickness, but that's the first shot he's missed.
And Tennessee not afraid to switch out the 1 through 4. They don't want Stokes on the ball, but everyone else, they have pretty good confidence to switch out on.
And they're going to call it foul on Finney Smith, who made a pretty good play on the ball, but he got a hand in there and picked up his second personal. 7:13 remaining in the first half of Game 1 of semifinal Saturday from Atlanta. The SEC on ESPN. Scotty Wilbekin's got 10 points, but Florida trails by 2. Shannon will be up next with Billy D.
When Martin Cooper invented the...
Oh, how would you describe what you've seen out of you guys so far?
I think our guys are focused. They're playing hard. Obviously, Tennessee's good. They're playing hard, too. You know, we got down by 6 or 7 there and kind of got back into it. We had a chance to tie it. We had a couple turnovers there. But overall, I think it's a long way to go and just got to keep battling.
What was the key to getting back into this game?
Well, I thought we got some stops. We got hurt on some second chance points, which hurt us. When we subbed, that really hurt us because we had a 5 or 6 point lead. And guys come off the bench, didn't do as well as they needed to. Hopefully when they get back in there, they can do a better job. But, you know, we're going to battle and fight, and, you know, it's going to be a long game.
Thank you, Billy.
Thank you.
Part of being a coach of the year and as good a coach as Billy is he spent that nice, calm time with Shannon, and the rest of the time he was pretty much in the official's face. And all in all, he's still got a smile on his face.
Yeah, Joe Lindsay and Doug Shouts handle it really well. They listened to Billy Donovan. He wasn't disrespectful in terms of the type of language that he was using. He was very strong getting his point across. And then Lindsay and Shouse walked away from him. Billy Donovan came back at him one more time. And Joe said, I've given you a warning. That's enough. Billy goes back to coaching his team.
And now he's standing next to Pat Adams. And Pat's saying, I'll take care of those guys, Billy.
I'll tell you what. This is a terrific officiating crew, Brad.
It is.
Listen to Billy Donovan. It will not influence one call that they make in this game. Not one call.
Under 7 minutes. Tennessee by 2. They've led by as many as 7. And that one tipped out of bounds by Florida.
It's hard.
13 on the shot clock.
Partner, it's hard to beat relentless. It's hard to beat relentless. And you watch Florida, even in their zone defense, they are relentless at staying in a stance and talking. Most teams across the country, when you go zone, the guy on the ball will be in a stance. The other four guys will be standing up, not the Florida Gators.
Tough spot to throw in from right in front of the opponent's bench in the corner. Got it into Stokes, though. Jarnell. Double team, 7 on the shot clock. And he's fouled. Well, that's not a good foul. He had nowhere to go with the basketball. And you get picks up his first foul.
Brad, you're not going to reach in on Jarnell Stokes. He's too strong and too powerful for a reach-in foul on this guy. Throw up a wall.
Florida does not have an offensive rebound yet. And we have 6:43 to go in the first half. And Stokes and Maimon are the reason, for the most part, that they're minus 8. In the paint as Jarnell has his 5th point. 6'6", 260-pound junior out of Memphis.
Now you break down this guy's game. He's shooting over 60% on offensive putbacks and shooting 67% as a cutter. He has such great hands. He scores at a high rate on moving action as an offensive rebounder or as a cutter. Very unique for a guy that's built like that.
Yep. Wilbekin just a touch pass down quickly to Patrick Young. And Young trying to work the paint for the hook shot. Foul's going to come before the shot. And it will be on Derek Reese, I believe. It is. So, Florida will have it out of bounds under their own basket. Frazier comes out. Frazier has yet to score today. A three-point, shouldn't just say three-point shooter, but when he gets hot, he's as good as anybody in the country at that. He sits. Devon Walker is out on the floor with Young, Yaguette, Hill, and Scotty Wilbekin. So basically a couple of point guards there. Nice inbounds play to get it to Young for his four-point.
Brad, it's a fist fight to catch the ball and then a foot fight to score on the block.
Martin all the way. Bounce pass to Stokes, who flushes it. Boy, that was great transition basketball right there by Tennessee.
Yeah, 6% body fat on Jarnell Stokes. He's as lively and has as much pop in his legs as he's had his entire career.
The rim down there is still scared. And going to have a foul.
I talked about scoring on the low block. It's a fist fight up top to get in catching position and then a foot fight to score. Patrick Jones won both. But then what do tough guys do? Because Stokes just got whipped at the other end, but he comes right back and runs with a passion and a fury and sends a message himself. Tough guys don't let one mistake become two, and Stokes is a very tough guy.
Wilbekin three off the inbounds off the front of the iron. He's missed his first three-point shot of the day.
Talking to Jordan McRae before the ball game, I said, give me one key. Before I could ask the question, he said, Scotty Wilbekin. It's all about Scotty Wilbekin and what we do with him or can do with him in this game.
Those two are going at it, running the baseline. In this case, Wilbekin defensively on McRae. There's a double team on Stokes. Has to cross-court it, and he threw it into row two.
Florida can trap you in three different ways, Brad. This time they come with a monster. The monster action is the closest big coming over. And that's a trap the breath out of you and not foul type trap. They can monster you. They can back trap you off of a cutter. And they can get scraped down off the closest guy on the first bounce. And they are very good in all three areas.
Wilbekin now. Going to run the baseline with Hill at the point. Walker in there. He's going to go straight up to the hoop. Airmailed it out of bounds. A little too anxious for the McDonald's All-America freshman who hasn't seen a lot of time. Played early yesterday in the win over Missouri. Out there right now to give Florida some minutes, but maybe a little too anxious to put the ball up.
That's not what he's in the game for.
No.
Interesting, I looked at Billy Donovan. Billy Donovan never made eye contact with him, though. He wants Walker to get confident as they head in this NCAA tournament.
Under 5 minutes in the half. McRae, that is a tough shot, and it's a beauty.
Over the long arms of Walker. I continue to talk about the wingspan that this cat plays with. Prototypical two guard waiting to happen in the NBA because of the shots that he can make around the glass.
Great elevation. Knew what spot to put it on the window way up high so nobody could touch it. And it was picture perfect. Now Yaguette is fouled in the lane. I think it's going to be Richardson. Two guys were there, but Richardson picks up his second. Watch this shot by McRae.
Well, he has so many good things that he does, but off of one or two bounces, the ability to take the ball away from the long arms of Chris Walker and get it up high on the glass. And this is a guy that's hard to guard because he can score from 24 feet and in as a three-point shooter. He scores outside the offense, can break off and get his own. And a great example, he is great. He is great at the glass.
Prather wanting to drive, going to get him to Yaguette. And again, Maimon comes out on Wilbekin. He wants some long arms in front of that long-range shooter.
Yep.
Prather almost walked with it, turned it over anyway.
Yeah, Prather had an open jump shot, but that's not who he is.
McRae, wow, through traffic that time.
And we're going to have a foul quickly in the front court on Tennessee. It's going to be on Amani Moore, I think.
I think it's a T on Amani Moore.
I think you're right.
Or maybe both ways.
Number four, Amani Moore. And for Florida,
You're right. It's a double foul. Prather and Armani Moore. Technicals. And we'll get a chance to look at that when we come back. We've got to take a timeout right now at 3:59 at Tennessee. Surprising the Florida Gators right now. 31-23.
ESPN College Basketball on ABTV.
All right, John, thanks. Just under 4 minutes remaining. And right now, Tennessee leading 31-23. Shannon talked with Konzo Martin during the break.
Coach, take me inside that huddle. What have some of the conversations between you and your players been like?
Just to keep battling, keep fighting, executing on both ends of the floor, carrying out our assignments on both ends of the floor. We're doing a solid job.
Florida does not have an offensive rebound, and they have 5 turnovers. What have you done that's been so effective defensively?
Got to keep them off the glass. And we're one of the best, if not the best, defensive rebounding team in SEC. Got to keep those guys off the glass. Got to make them take tough shots and make tough plays.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
All right, Shannon Swanson, thanks. Let's take you back, though, to the double technical. You're going to watch two guys get tangled up here. Prather gets tangled up with Armani Moore, and then Prather trying to trip him, and in the meantime, Jordan McCray goes down to scores on the other end. Pat Adams, you see, frantically trying to get a whistle and the double technical called. He did. Doug Shaws just came over and talked to you, Jimmy. I think I know what he said, but go ahead.
It continued from that point forward after the knockdown by Jordan McCray on the other end, and when they continued to go at each other, Pat Adams said, enough is enough. Double technical foul, resumption of play, and now the shot clock's not working. Brad Armani Moore and Casey Prather, as you said, they went at each other on this possession. And then at the end of the possession coming back, Pat Adams said, I warned you, I've had enough. Boom, boom, double technical foul.
That's why the basket still counts on the other end. Had Pat called that technical in the backcourt the first time he saw it, McCray's basket would not have counted. But it was continuation of play until Pat can get down there and get between the two guys and call a double technical.
He warned them on the first nose-to-nose.
Right.
You're not going to listen to my warning. We have to stick a veteran crew. I'm telling you, Billy Donovan and Konzo can coach hard and communicate all they want to with this officiating crew. They are on top of this game as well they should be.
That's Pat Adams. That's Joe Lindsay. And Doug Shaws just whistled for play to begin. 3:35 remaining in the half.
Any coach in this league would take these three officials in this type of game. Late clock.
Wilbekin for three. That one's short, too. He's missed his last couple of shots. Jordan McCray, an awkward landing on the rebound. And right now, Tennessee's got Florida on the ropes a little bit. Stokes kicks out McCray. Long three is too short. Frazier the rebound. I think it's going to have an offensive foul as he sent McCray to the floor.
Right, I talked about Jordan McCray's development as a defensive player. He can caboose shooters and bother them with a long wingspan, but this time they switch out on the ball screen, and he has to go to work as a post defender. He does a good job of getting lower than you get. You get gets frustrated, throws the elbow, and Joe Lindsay says, we're going the other way.
And right now the officials are sending a message, I think. Let's keep it on the up and up, guys.
Yep.
You know each other well. You played twice in the regular season. Florida won them both, won handily, won by single digits. Tennessee trying to return the favor, up by 8.
Tennessee continues to lay the wood in their screening action. They set the rules of the game early, and they have continued how they're playing.
Armani Moore trying to go over Patrick Young. Ball comes out to Wilbekin. He'll take it against McCray, who blocked it. And now scramble for the loose ball, and everybody on the deck. And it's a tie-up. It's going to be Florida ball. Jordan McCray is fired up. Native of Georgia. Wilbekin, as Jimmy said earlier, giving away about 4 inches in height. And watch this. Wilbekin's going to take it to him, and McCray said, not on my dime.
And I will say it again. It is hard to beat relentless effort. And both these clubs are bringing it in that area right now. And the passion and the leadership and the body language that Jordan McCray is playing with, I've said it before, body language never whispers, it screams.
He was screaming.
Jordan McCray has terrific body language so far.
And a pretty good scream as well.
Absolutely.
Florida now, Frazier will inbound. lobbing it in to Yeget.
As he goes body to body on the baseline out of bounds defense.
Matt Young turns on Stokes. Goes over it. Too hard off the glass. And it might be Yeget again, and that's trouble for him. That's three.
Will Yeget is third personal foul. Team foul number nine.
So Yeget's going to have to sit, and it's 1-1 walking the other way. Now coming up tomorrow, you've been waiting for it. Selection Sunday, 5:30 SportsCenter provides wall-to-wall coverage of the brackets as they're announced. At 7, our experts will break it all down with 2 hours of bracketology. Who's in, whose bubble is burst, and who's poised to make a run to the Final Four. It's Selection Sunday on ESPN and also live on Watch ESPN tomorrow. All starts at 5:30 Eastern.
Well, we know the number one seeds. Florida, I believe, will be the overall number one seed. Wichita State, Arizona, that fourth one now is up for discussion. Could very well be the winner of that Big Ten. Kansas has played their way out. I don't think Duke has a strong enough overall resume. Wisconsin and Michigan still in the mix.
Jerome Heyman has 7 points here in the first half.
Two of the great voices in the SEC on this floor right now. Jerome Heyman from Tennessee and Scotty Wilbekin from Florida. The guys just, they are attached to the voice of those two guys respectively.
Wilbekin better start to use his team's down 10. Frazier, that's a guy they'd like to get hot. He doesn't get a shot, though, because McCray fouled him before the move. And that'll be the first on Jordan McCray.
But Frazier averages less than 2 free throw attempts per game.
And he's an 85% free throw shooter.
So McCray, all you have to do is just run him off the three-point line and force him to do something off the bounce. McCray lost his discipline just for a second, left his feet, and Frazier can't make him pay.
A 10-point advantage, Tennessee. Florida hasn't had any points in almost 5 minutes.
I don't know about you. I can see it in Tennessee's eyes and how they carry themselves. They think they're good enough to win this thing by double figures, if not more.
You're right.
You agree?
Especially with guys like Maimon inside, but that's a nice play by Devon Walker. Casey Hill going the other way and scoring.
The speed of the transition game of Florida goes to another level when Hill comes in. As good as Wilbekin is as the point guard, Hill is actually a faster and better transition point guard for Florida.
Florida trying to apply pressure again, and again, Tennessee handles it easily. Maimon cross-courts it. Here's a pull-up jumper by McCray. Jordan McCray's got 10.
The fine by Jerome Maimon. Florida doesn't respect him as much as Stokes. They don't double-team him, allows Maimon to square up and get vision as a passer across the baseline.
There's a lot of orange in here, two different colors, but the Tennessee orange right now making some noise, and Scotty Wilbekin's tied up, and it's going back to Tennessee.
Can you kill the will that Tennessee has been playing with over the last 5 or 6 ball games on the defensive end? Yes, they're dialed in on their scouting report. Yes, they're staying in a stance. They're blowing up screens. But it is the will that they bring to the floor right now defensively that is hard to kill.
Brought into the front court. There's about a 13-second difference on the game clock and the shot clock. And Tennessee, a comfortable double-digit lead. Not sure I'd think about saying Florida would love to get it back to single digits before halftime. That's how well Tennessee's played. Might get worse for the Gators. Maimon, kick out, 5 to shoot. McCray working on Walker. Maimon had to put it up quickly. And shot clock violation. It hit the window, didn't hit the rim. So good defensive job there by Florida. Tennessee turns it over. Tennessee defense that Jimmy talked about earlier. Wow. Today, 25 points. By the way, halftime, the last time these two teams played, Tennessee led by 1. They're going to lead for sure here by 10 or less. Wilbekin straight over Moore. Got it. Big shot.
for Florida just before the buzzer.
Best point guard in the country is Scotty Wilbekin. He answers the bell every single time. You can put him on the point, you can put him on the two, you can slide him through the three defensively. He will erase the problem. On the offensive end, you need to make a tough two, he will. And to close out the half, the hands are down and Wilbekin says, thank you very much.
Keep this one in mind, everybody. From double digits to seven is a huge difference as they head to the locker room. 35-28, just about set to start the second half. Welcome back to Atlanta, everybody. Brad Nessler and Jimmy Dykes. Shannon will be along in a minute. Partner, seven times this year, Florida trailed at halftime. Two of those times they lost. UConn and Wisconsin, their only two losses of the season. They're going to have to dig themselves out of a hole right here, too.
Well, if there's a team in the country that can do it, the trust factor I have with the Florida Gators is it because of those four really cool seniors. So they're not going to go away without a fist fight. Tennessee's happy to have a fist fight as well. Very important in this ball game. Florida has put the press on 14 times, and Tennessee has only turned it over twice. Why? Well, first of all, in the half court, Florida is up against a team in Tennessee that is being very strong, very physical, man-to-man type ball game. Again, they set the rules early in how we're going to play the game. We're going to drive this thing at the paint and score around the rim. They got 20 paint points, Tennessee does so far. Leading scorer is McCray because of his length, and Scotty Wilbekin because he's the best point guard in college basketball.
And remember, Wilbekin hit a three-pointer at the buzzer when it was a double-digit lead, seven now, and you look down the line 20 minutes from now, or 20 minutes from now on the clock, and think how big that three may be. We'll track that. The largest deficit Florida had this season was 11 points. That was Wisconsin. They lost. Largest deficit they came back from was Auburn, down by nine. They won that one. Can they come back from seven down here in the second half of semifinal Saturday? That's our question. We'll find out our answer in the next hour. And a steal by Tennessee to open up the second half. And Wilbekin takes it right back from Barton. And he's fouled by Maimon. Let's check in with Shannon.
Well, Brad, Billy Donovan told me that yesterday he felt like his veteran players didn't give them enough, and today he continues to think that his younger players are not giving enough. He said foul troubles hurt them, turnovers have hurt him, but overall, when they move the ball, he feels like the offense is pretty good. Now, earlier today, Jarnell Stokes told me the last time they played Florida, they felt like Florida wanted it more. The next 20 minutes will prove who wants it more.
Good point. Tennessee lost that one 67-58, but it was a lot tighter than the first game. Prater opens up the scoring in the second half.
Brady had to fight for his spot because Tennessee did a good job of a short closeout, making him into a jump shooter where he had no part of it and still found his way to the rim.
Jordan McCray almost stepped on the sideline. Jarnell Stokes, big sweep and hook and missed it. And the rebound comes off to Florida. And Michael Frazier, who has yet to score, by the way. Patrick Young. Wow, what a move, a shoulder into Stokes, and then goes left-hand baseline. That was nice.
And in the first half, Antonio Barton and Thompson played the 20 minutes at the point guard spot. They only had one turnover, another big reason why Tennessee has the lead. Will they hold up in this second half against the relentless pressure of Florida?
We go back to the end of the first half. We mentioned it a minute ago. It's a 7-0 Florida run, and that's a three-point game. Stokes from just inside the foul line. Frazier, another rebound. Let's see who got tangled up, though. Might be Finney Smith and Maimon. It could be on Florida.
As you'd expect, Scotty Wilbekin has triggered this quick start for Florida in the second half. I talked about what he does as a defensive player, playing with a great base and hot hands around that basketball. Barton got loose with it. Only the second turnover, though, out of that point guard spot for Tennessee in this ballgame.
We thought that would be their weak link today,
yes.
And they played very well at the point.
Yeah, but they're going to have to hold up there now with 18 to go.
That foul was on Benny Smith, his third for the Gators. So he and Yaget each have three. McCray, long jumper.
That even in Florida's zone defense, they're trapping that low block area. They always want to stay the aggressor.
Gators just got sloppy there. And an easy steal for Richardson. So Florida gives it right back to Tennessee. McCray wants to get it to Stokes, and Young is really doing a good job banging with him on the low block. Richardson slices inside. Great move.
And a good seal off by Jermon Maimon. And Richardson got just enough of a crack to tap to attack that to the low flip.
At some point, Florida's got to get Frazier a shot. They've got to get somebody else in the groove scoring, except just Wilmington. There's a guy that can help the cause. Missed it. Young had it swatted out of there by Stokes.
That Florida is only a 48% field goal team on putbacks. That's not a high number. You're shooting less than 50% on offensive putbacks. That number needs to go up.
McCray threw a double team. Walked with it. One too many steps for Jordan.
Well, Florida, again, they don't have a lot of length inside themselves. I mean, Patrick Young is only 6'8", and I think that's the reason why they struggle on offensive putbacks. They get on the offensive glass, but they're not converting at a high rate. Patrick Young is not really an above-the-rim guy, and Walker is too small and thin so far to be effective in that area as well.
Let's see how it goes now with Maimon on the bench for Tennessee and Young on the bench for Florida. That means Stokes is the power man out there, and Yegette's the only other guy with any size, and he's playing with three fouls.
Well, they're going to have to double-team Stokes early now because of just the massive power that he has on Florida.
Prather. Nice spin. Sometimes you look at Casey Prather and you go, wow, why doesn't he do that all the time? Cross-court pass, dangerous, but McCray handles it. Lead back down to three. We're 4 minutes into the second half.
And Barton continues to not be rattled. He had a pretty good hot trap on him, but he found a weak side of the floor with a skip pass.
Played better today than he did against Missouri. South Carolina, rather. And now in some traffic, they do turn it over. Prather, he's got Frazier with him. Frazier up, under, around, and in. Nice teamwork that time.
It's an accumulation of the pressure that Florida gets to you in the second half. You might be starting to see the beginning of it right now. Will Conzo use a timeout because he knows his club is a turnover away from maybe coming unraveled, but we got the TV timeout coming up with the next dead ball.
That double-digit lead earlier is down to one. And out of bounds to Florida. Here come the Gators. 15-12 to play. Gators open up the second half on an 8-2 run. Prather up on the window. And then even prettier, his dime to Frazier. 37-30.
I do not trust Iowa. I do not trust Oklahoma. I don't trust North Carolina. They gave up 80 last night because they don't fight on the defensive end of the floor. I trust Florida. I trust Wichita State. I trust Virginia. I trust Louisville. I trust Arizona in that department as well. If you're not fighting by this time of the season, you're not going to flip a switch and start next week. These two teams today, again, it's hard to beat relentless effort and fight.
Florida has a chance to regain the lead for the first time since the first half. Frazier will try it. Short on a three. Yegette keeps it alive.
Billy Donovan trying to get Frazier going with a set play off the timeout.
Hill, Florida leads.
Florida leads and the press is going to get hot.
Richardson, look out behind you.
Good voice by McCray to alert Richardson. Look out, Josh.
I thought maybe it was me that he heard.
And maybe he heard you too. Were you talking early, loud, and constant? If not, you need to sit down right here beside me and we'll talk about it.
And Wilmington comes up with a steal and then gets fouled by McCray, who couldn't get his balance and bumps him. Here's the Tennessee resume brought to you by Allstate. You can go to ESPN.com and sign up for the tournament challenge.
Brad, I think they're safe with quality wins on a neutral floor against Xavier, a beatdown of Virginia that's going to have terrific shelf life in the eyes of the selection committee. Their win against Missouri last Saturday, they sent a message. How they look right now in the eye test, there's a lot of people on that selection committee. I've visited with a couple of them in the last month. They are really dialed in watching ball games and trusting what they see and trusting what they hear. You can tell by watching Tennessee, they look like a team that's going to be very dangerous as a 10 or 11 seed.
You've always talked about that quality win over Virginia. We understand Virginia's up by five on Pitt right now. And the ACC tournament in Greensboro.
And win today by Tennessee, I think, bumps them up to possibly a 9 seed. A loss, they're going to probably go in still as an 11 seed.
Benny Smith tried the long jumper and missed it. Now let's see if Tennessee can play from behind, as we kiddingly said on the opening basket after they had not trailed for five games and 200 minutes. They're behind now. No longer are they. Maimon's got 10. And Tennessee back in front.
And Brad is a quick hitter before the double team on the low block by Florida could come into play.
Wilbekin way too strong on the three-pointer and off the mark as well. Stokes working against Yegette. Remember, Yegette's got three fouls. Stokes isn't going to challenge him, though. Brings it back out. McCray bumped off Wilbekin and missed the jumper. Casey Hill, just a blur, going in and had it blocked. Good job by Armani Moore, I think the guy that got it. McCray the other way and the lay-in. Tennessee goes back in front by three.
Yeah, a lot of things about Jordan McCray, Brad. Great balance in his game. Comes into today, 129 attempts as a spot-up shooter. Terrific in transition. And when Tennessee got punched in the nose, they got themselves back up and started punching back.
Armani Moore, Kennesaw, Georgia.
Important, projecting the guy at the next level. Does he have an NBA skill? He's wired to score, Brad. He can score from 24 feet and in, although the elbow is out a little bit too much. Hey, I still trust him from there. And does he get it? That may be the most important thing out of all five of those check marks. I wouldn't have said Jordan McCray gets it as a freshman or a sophomore. Now he does. This is a guy that can take hard coaching. He's a tougher guy from being under Konzo Martin. I think he has all the intangibles, and I love Jordan McCray at the next level because he answers yes to all five of those key questions in my evaluation.
I remember a couple of years ago, you and I were doing the games, and he would take a shot, and we'd look at each other and roll our eyes. I haven't rolled my eyes at him all year. Tough rebound by Jonnell Stokes. So again, Florida finds itself trailing, this time by three. Moore, the pick and roll, and Maynard muscles it up. Yegette luckily didn't get another foul, but Stokes is going to get the putback.
There he is, one of the top four or five offensive rebounders in college basketball. Another below-the-rim rebound by Jarnell Stokes because he absolutely whips you and wears you out with his lower body.
10th point, fifth rebound for Stokes. Hill, a lob underneath. Not a good pass.
Can't throw a lob low. You can't throw a lob low if you're Casey Hill.
Stokes faces your guess. Going to take it from the foul line. And I think Maimon pushed Young underneath. And Maimon will pick up his third foul. Florida was down earlier. They came back to lead by one. But now, Tennessee on another run. Can the number one team and the senior-laden Gators come back from behind again? Western Conference, Brad Nessler, Jimmy Dyke, Shannon Spake, and our ESPN ABC crew in Atlanta, where fourth seed Tennessee leads not only top seed, but top-ranked Florida by five with 11:39 to go. Remember, Florida was down 10. Scotty Wilbekin hit a three at the buzzer at halftime to cut it to seven. Then they went on a roll to open the second half to lead by one. And now trailing again by five. And Stokes is going to foul Patrick Young from behind. And Jarnell Stokes is trying to tell the officials, I was just trying to land. I wasn't trying to knock him into DeKalb County.
Patrick Young is so good in the sprint-out ball screen action, and once he sets the screen, he sprints right back to the low block. And very hard for Stokes to handle. I expect for Florida to drag Jarnell Stokes into a lot of ball screens remaining 11:20 of this game.
Going to get it right back to Young against Stokes. Got to get it out of there, and did.
How low and wide was Stokes defensive is terrific.
Prater. Not his shot for the most part. Rebound comes off to Tennessee. 11 minutes to go.
And a hit first mentality in terms of checking off people. Tennessee in this ball game.
Boy, what a battle between Young and Stokes again on the other end. Those two are going to have bruises tomorrow, no matter who wins. Double team on McCray. 9 on the shot clock.
This is where Tennessee can be a little bit shaky. Who can go get their own?
Martin's going to try to get it. Didn't touch anything. He tried to steal it after the miss, but Florida brings it the other way.
I want the ball in the hands of McCray late clock.
Exactly. So versatile, a lot of different things he can do. You talked about it. Young flushes it. Stokes just let him go. On a blow by, Patrick Young has got eight.
One of Billy Donovan's concerns in the first half was his bench letting down, with Dorian Finney-Smith now active in this ball game as a presser.
Right to Wilbekin. Underneath and getting mugged by Armani Moore was Finney-Smith.
Brad, when Florida scores at the rim, when they score right at the rim around the basket, and the press gets really hot, and Dorian Finney-Smith sells the ball fake. Now the press is on hot. And they can light you up. You inbounds that basketball in the middle part of the floor, you're in a lot of trouble. And boy, Florida, they can put it on you in a hurry.
Sixth man of the year at the free throw line. He has not scored yet today. Still hasn't. One flaw, if Florida has one, is how their big men shoot free throws.
Yeah. 67% as a team overall. I talked about it yesterday. Dorian Finney-Smith, Casey Hill, and Chris Walker would start for about half the teams that are going to be in that NCAA tournament. And they come off the bench for Florida.
Missed both. No harm done on the Tennessee turnover other than one more foul picked up. And we're past the midway point of the second half.
Florida press one out of five from the free throw line in this game.
That's not going to do it in the NCAA tournament or the SEC tournament for that matter. Double team on McCray, and Tennessee takes the timeout to get him out of trouble. 9:42 remaining at the Georgia Dome. Game one of two today. And Tennessee trying to shock number one Florida.
How can power consumption in China impact wool exports from New Zealand, textile production in Spain, and the use of medical technology in the U.S.? At T. Rowe Price, we understand the connections of a complex global economy. It's just one reason over 75% of our mutual funds beat their 10-year Lipper average. T. Rowe Price. Invest with confidence. Request a prospectus or summary prospectus with investment information, risks, fees, and expenses to read and consider carefully before investing.
Tennessee to inbound. Maimon, McCray, Richardson, Stokes, and Darius Thompson, the freshman, to bring it in. Florida counters with Prater, Kenny Smith, Young, Frazier, and Scotty Wilbekin on the floor. Six on the shot clock for the Volunteers. McCray, baseline jumper. Rebound will come off to Frazier.
Now Florida goes zone out of the timeout. Tennessee got a pretty good look, though.
Prather got it into Young in low. That time, Maimon was a step too slow. Here comes the trap in the backcourt. Again, Maimon's was buster to get it into the front court, but he got ripped from behind. Turnover, Tennessee. Frazier for the lead. Got it!
Right basket by Michael Frazier. Timeout, Tennessee.
Brett, I've talked about the back pursuit that Florida puts on you in their press. It is relentless. Jerron Maimon makes a mistake. He's been good when the defense has all been in front of him, but from behind, he makes a critical error right here. Watch Jerron Maimon. One, two, three, four. Four dribbles on the same side of his body against the back pressure of Florida will not work. They get the back tap, and then Frazier gets loose in transition, and that's what I'm talking about. Florida can put it on you very quickly.
Quickly, things can turn as we check in with Shannon.
A little bit of foreshadowing from Jarnell Stokes this morning when I spoke with him. He told me Michael Frazier is the X factor on this Florida Gators team. He said that this morning. He doesn't score a lot in this game, but when he does, it's big.
He's hit a couple of big ones. One in transition on an up and under reverse layup. And then that three-pointer that just put Florida back in front, averaging the last four games, almost 19 a game, and great three-point shooting, including 11 against South Carolina. Today, only 5 points, but none bigger than the last one. Florida in front by Deuce. Here comes the trap on the freshman. Having a little trouble. Got it to Stokes.
Boy, good step through by Thompson to not panic. Kid has kind of grown up within this ball game at that point guard spot.
Stokes asking for it against Young. Draws a double team with Finney-Smith. Got to get rid of it. Richardson for the lead. Short on a three.
For continuing to not let Jarnell Stokes do anything on the low block. Now they're coming with an instant monster trap with the basketball, not letting him work.
Finney-Smith's triple is too long.
Now what's Konzo Martin going to do, Brad? He knows that the heat is on Jarnell Stokes on any low block touch. Does he move him to the elbow, move him to the mid post? It's hard to trap when Jarnell Stokes starts getting touches around the elbow, and there's what Konzo Martin does with him.
Run him out on top, and sets a pick for McCray. McCray wanted to get it back to him and couldn't. And congestion inside, and a foul. Nope, it's going to be a 3-second violation. .751 remaining. Top-ranked Florida by two. He took it back to lead by five, and now we seesaw back with Florida up by two.
Interesting, Florida has got their full-court press set 20 times in this game. 20 times Billy Donovan's had his press set. Tennessee's only turned it over four times against those 20 full-court pressure situations. That's a very good number for Konzo to work with. Watch out.
Lob was a little too high for Prather.
Foul turns to Will Yeggett.
And Yeggett finally picked up his fourth foul, trying to battle for that miss. We've been playing with three fouls since about midway through the first half.
Brad, that's another reason why Florida is aggressive at trapping the ball off the block. They don't have the depth on their front line to hold up with foul trouble, so they trap the ball out of there to allow you to not go one-on-one and get them even more foul trouble.
Wilbekin almost came up with a steal on Jordan McCray. Stokes now is working against Finney-Smith, and that's a little bit of a size mismatch. McCray can't shake Wilbekin. Eight on the shot clock. He's going to go over everybody. Rimmed it out. Maven keeps it alive, and a new clock for the Volunteers.
Maven is so good at pushing off without pushing off.
Richardson wide open. Knew from the start it wasn't going to go. Stokes was going to go up and slam it, and now Florida ties him up. It's going to still be Tennessee ball, but it changes the possession arrow, and it saved the basket.
Well, the quick hands of Jarnell Stokes and the quick hands of Scotty Wilbekin. One guy weighs 260, another guy weighs
maybe a buck 60.
Yeah, 180 pounds at the most. But watch this. Maimon again, keeping the ball alive, and then the Velcro's paws of Jarnell Stokes, but Scotty Wilbekin comes in, and you talk about a terrific dig down. Look how low Scotty Wilbekin gets in order to interfere with that basketball. Again, another play made by Wilbekin because he has a terrifically strong base at the key points of the game.
Jerron Maimon, Jimmy, during that break, went to the bench, and he's kind of playing with his knee. Remember, knee surgery kept him out all of last year, and he was the first one to hit the deck in the initial pileup that looked like turn three of a NASCAR race. He's over there kind of rubbing it, but I think he's okay.
He'll kind of drag that leg around in warm-ups at times. But again, you're trying to cut the heart out of a kid that has a stronger will that we have.
Martin will bring it on top with 6:45 to go.
So Konzo Martin now moving Jarnell Stokes off that low block, trying to get him move more of a score off of action.
Stokes double-teamed again immediately. Now McCray. Good defense by Florida. Tennessee's got to come back on top for one more reset. Richardson had it swiped by Frazier. And Frazier will take it in himself. Nope, they're going to wave it off.
The effort of Jarnell Stokes, Brad, because he was on the low block when the turnover occurred. And what did Jarnell Stokes do? In full sprint mode to get his feet set. It was a nice rip by Frazier. And Stokes is behind the play at this point. Look at Jarnell Stokes. But again, 6% body fat, floods the floor at the front of the rim to protect it. Very well done. I don't like Stokes on that low block right now. He's more of a cutter and a score off of action, and that's what Tennessee needs to get him involved in.
McCray way off the mark on the jumper. trying to create something, trying to tie it, and couldn't. Still Florida by two, and we're under six to play. Wilbekin thought about getting it into Young, I think. Cross-courted instead to Freddie Smith. Kicked out of bounds by Amani Moore.
Sometimes, partner, you just have to compete and get it done. And I think that's what it's going to boil down to with 5:35 to go. There are no secrets. There are no special plays right now that any coach can go to. What five guys can you put on the floor, your most competitive dudes, to try to close this thing out?
Gut check in both directions. Young. Prater got tangled up on the inside. I think he was just trying to pass it out of there. Nonetheless, he drew the foul. And it's on Richardson. Tennessee 54% in the first half. And Florida started to clamp down, and it's dropped more than in half. Same with their points in the paint and almost double in their turnovers.
What did Florida do yesterday, Brad? They had a problem in the first half guarding the basketball, and they fixed it in the second half. Same thing today. Tennessee was driving that ball at the paint, and Florida has fixed the problem within the game. And I talked about it yesterday, and I firmly believe it. Great teams fix the problem right now. They don't wait to watch the film or the next day walk through the next practice. They can fix the problem within the game, and normally that starts with a point guard that can fix it for you.
Florida's problem right now, they've hit one free throw all day. Still, one free throw all day. Tennessee hasn't had any points in 7 minutes.
Florida so good in the second half of the last two ball games, plus 24 and plus 23. A sign of a mature team that you have to put them away. You may have to put them away twice within the same game.
Stokes muscles inside. They call a foul. I'm not sure that wasn't ball, but the foul are going to call on Young.
Brad, that's what I've been calling for Jarnell Stokes. Make him a score off of action. Don't throw it to him on the low block because they're trapping the life out of him on the catch. Put him at the elbow, move him around on the floor, and let his quicker-than-you-think body start to make some punishing drives against Florida.
There was contact there by Young. Good call. And Stokes hits the first as we check in with Shannon.
Brad, confident and just hard-fighting team. That is exactly how Jarnell Stokes described the end of this regular season for this Tennessee team. He told me even he has been getting emotional. He knows that the season is coming to an end. There's a lot of veterans on this team, and they are just playing as one. It's really all starting to fit together.
And his free throws fit together twice, and we're tied for the first time in the second half. Whistle down low. And Jerron Maimon is called for the foul. And a technical on top of it. Whatever he said to Pat Adams didn't go over very well. Apparently threw an elbow.
Jerron Maimon makes a costly mistake. He continues to plead his case. Pat Adams gives him an explanation. Jarnell Stokes says something else that gives him a look. Pat Adams almost ate his whistle trying to call the tee.
He's gone, Jimmy.
That's huge.
Well, he called a foul and a technical. That should be it, right?
Yes, regardless of what, I think Jerron Maimon had a good point. He's entitled to his spot on the floor. Now, I'm not sure the Florida player didn't initiate the contact, but regardless, he's too important to his ball club to get caught up with a tee. And that was just, again, too big body. Young threw a little bit of a shot. Maimon threw a little bit of shot at the same time. But Jerron Maimon is an older player. You trust his voice. You trust all the qualities about him. He lost his discipline at a key time for Tennessee.
Meanwhile, the technicals. Finally, Florida hit some free throws courtesy of Michael Frazier with the technical shots. Now it's Patrick Young with the initial foul on Maimon. And Jerron's gone with 10 points and 8 rebounds.
As a big, big blow to send Tennessee's chances in this ballgame.
Another free throw finally drops. And now Florida's hit three straight to lead by three.
If very physical ball game.
Feel bad, actually, for Jaron Maimon that this is the last time he's playing in the SEC tournament by fouling out with a technical, but that could very well be the case because Patrick Young has just put Florida out by four.
Grant, it's been a fight, and look at Florida defensively, what they're doing. They're defending without fouling, only 14 fouls on the Gators.
McCray took it in, Stokes trying to put it back up there, and he's fouled. It'll be on Finney Smith, and that'll be his fourth.
Brett, I saw this Tennessee ball club go blow for blow, punch for punch, with the other number one seed that we know for sure in Wichita State back in the middle of December. And now they're doing the same thing with what I think is going to be the overall number one seed. You don't want any part of Tennessee, I'm telling you, in the NCAA tournament as an 11 seed, because that's about where they're going to end up being slotted.
Stokes, after hitting four straight, misses that one. This is Florida's biggest lead, matching its biggest lead of the game, in fact. Stokes just cut into that by one. 13 for Jarnell. 4:20 to go.
I said Scotty Wilbekin owns the game from the film to the final product. Right now with 4:15, your point guard has to own the moment. And I trust Wilbekin as much as any guard out there.
His three-pointer at the buzzer in the first half is the difference in the game right now. Young, left hand on the baseline. Good-looking move. Couldn't get it. And then there's a push underneath. It's going to be on Finney Smith again, and he's gone. So the second player has fouled out of the game. He leaves with no points. Sixth man of the year, and the SEC is gone as well.
And Florida's leading rebounder takes a seat. On the season, Dorian Finney-Smith, when he checks in, that's another thing that he does. He really gets on that backboard. So Jaron Maimon, a rebounding machine for Tennessee, sits, and now Dorian Finney-Smith as well.
Keep this in mind, Jimmy. Will Yegetz coming back on the floor as Finney-Smith sits. He's playing with four. With four to play.
Probably 23 or 24 times now in this game, Billy Donovan's got his full court press set and only four turnovers for Tennessee. If you told Conjo Martin before the game that would be the ratio, he said, I'll take it right now.
Absolutely. Under 4 minutes. McCray trying to work on Wilbekin.
Brad, that's best on best is what that is. That's best on best. Who can win this battle?
Eight to shoot. He picks up his dribble, and they'll bring it up to Richardson. And now somebody's going to have to put it up. Richardson on a runner. Didn't even get near the basket. Yegette will handle it and get it to Wilbekin again.
Richardson had McCray breaking down in front of Tennessee's bench wide open.
Florida takes a timeout.
Brad, Richardson drove the ball with his head down instead of his eyes up. McCray was available for a late clock shot.
Florida leading by three. 3:20 remaining. What a game it's been. Let's take a look at the latest dish on the SEC tournament brought to you by the Dish Network. As you look at Joe Linardi's bracketology, the headlines today, you look at it, Jimmy, with a win, out a win. NC State pulled off a big one yesterday.
Yep. I believe Tulsa locked it up if I was kind of trying to scroll through things earlier today. I think they won the ball game. Scotty Wilbekin, Brad, all the things that he does. He's scoring right at 1 point per play, which is an excellent rating. As a pick-and-roll handler, 104 plays coming in. He's shooting 51% as an adjusted field goal percentage guy because of his ability to make a pull-up three like he did late in the first half. And he only turns it over 14% of the time as a pick-and-roll handler. So to close out a ball game, Billy Donovan knows he has as trustworthy of a pick-and-roll handling point guard that we have in the college game. And Conjo Martin now goes to his 1-3-1 to stay away from that pick-and-roll action that Florida can throw at you.
Wilbekin hasn't scored in the second half. Missed a three there. Had a pretty good look. And we've got 3 minutes to play. And right now, this one feels to me, Jimmy, like a tug of war with about 1,000 pounds on each side. And who's going to let that cord go across the midpoint of the sand?
Cannot flinch, cannot give in. You have to fight for everything you get in this ball game.
McCray, triple. Got it!
Yeah, well done by Jarnell Stokes. He adjusted like Hanzo Martin to take Stokes' grab off the low block, put him at the mid post of the elbow. Now he's becoming effective as a driver and as a passer.
Another tie at 49, 2.5 to play. McCray with 15 and a big three-pointer, his first triple of the day. Patrick Young straight up with a left hand without putting it on the floor. And Florida back in front.
He was an all left shoulder, right paw, jump hook guy until 2 years ago. But we've watched him over the years work with a medicine ball before practice and before games. Now he has both shoulders that he can go to.
It's funny, there's a buzz in here right now because this has been such a good game. And there's a lot of Kentucky fans in here. And they're just cheering because they like good basketball. And a steal by Florida.
Stokes got a little careless. He got the ball, Brad, outside of his shoulder area and exposed the ball to a second defender coming in.
It's a 10th turnover the second half by Tennessee.
There's the ball screen I talked about with Wilberman. He's so good off of it.
He knew who to leave it to, and that was Frazier. And Frazier trying to take it inside, and it's swatted down by McCray. And now McCray the other way. He lost the handle. Another Tennessee turnover. Prather, open floor. And wait a minute. He's grabbed by the waist. It's going to be a regular foul on Antonio Barton on the breakaway. Florida can't seem to break away from Tennessee. They do lead by two, trying to win their 25th straight game. Tennessee's trying to spoil the Gator party. Wesley Judd, the biggest Kentucky fan in the world. Howie Mandel. And on Monday, Uma Thurman, Jimmy Kimmel Live all next week, 11:30, 10:30 Central Time on ABC. Let's take you back to the foul.
Brad, it's a two-point game that could swell now because this is a flagrant one foul. When I saw it live, it caught my eye. They made a common foul call, but there's no play on the basketball. That's a wraparound by Barton at a bad time. So lack of discipline by Barton with a flagrant one, a lack of discipline by Maimon when he wouldn't walk away from Pat Adams, and maybe these are the two plays that cost Tennessee from sliding into the championship. A minute 21 to go. It's two free throws for Florida and the basketball.
Casey Prather has missed his two previous attempts from the foul line.
You know what, though? I trust any four of those Florida seniors on the free throw strike. Even Young. I know the dude doesn't shoot free throws well. But tough guys right now trying to close out a game is what you want.
Joe Lindsay coming over to make sure that we're good at on the call. Pat Adams already straightened it out with Jimmy. Thanks, guys, for the help. Casey Prather, 6'6 senior out of Jackson, Tennessee. Ironically enough, playing against his home state and hits the free throw.
He's been there 157 times on the season coming in, more than any other Gator, so you know he's confident standing there in front of 20,000 all by himself.
Wow, was he ever. Two huge free throws.
I love tough guys on the free throw stripe to close out ball games if I'm coaching. I'll take a 48% free throw shooter if he's tough over a 75% free throw shooter if he's not.
Almost as importantly.
That's a flagrant one.
And this one's on Wilbekin.
They will go. They may go look at this now.
Is that on Wilbekin or Young?
Wilbekin. He took a legit shot to the chops. Did Bart watch Wilbekin? Comes through. Oh, no. That's going to be. They've made the call. Yeah, there's contact.
Well, he hit the end of his nose,
yeah,
maybe.
The first elbow came through, and it clipped him.
I think it might be best supporting actor, but that's just me.
They're going to look at this close. Does that right? Man, I don't know. You're right. That's this is why it's very important for them to be able to go to the monitor right now, Brad. They made the call on the floor of a foul. So now they go to the monitor, and they have options. They can take the foul away. That's new this year. It could be a flagrant two, a flagrant one, a common foul, or no foul. You can't go to the monitor and call a foul, but you can actually go over there and take one away.
Good point. That's the key ingredient right here, I think. So
So right now it's Joe Lindsay and Doug Shiles that are in there with the monitor. And they're seeing what you're seeing at home, folks. Or just so you know.
Well, his head rocks back.
Here's a different angle.
That angle looks like he clipped him. And if it is, best supporting actor, and he does a great job because, boom, if that's the contact occurring, that's where it is. The eyes are shut and Barton drops. I don't know. I don't know if there's enough there to overturn it one way or the other,
yeah,
to be honest
true.
With you. We've looked at it seven or eight times like the officials have.
I'm going to zoom it in a little bit. Here comes Wilbekin trying to get out of the way.
It is a crucial call right now for Doug Shiles and Pat Adams and Joe Lindsay. Only two guys can be at the monitor at the same time. I believe they've already rotated through over there.
They didn't have replay on the phantom punch of Cassius Clay, then later Muhammad Ali against Sonny Liston. But we have it. A lot of people didn't see that punch at all.
They
you realize
not.
That.
And, you know, Barton is... He's climbed right up into Wilbekin.
Well, we not only have our officials that are working the game, but our alternate official. We got everybody over there having as close a look as you're getting. Now, if you're home watching or you're somewhere in your favorite watering hole watching, you're seeing this. They're not showing it on the Jumbotron here inside the Georgia Dome.
Let me ask you this. If you call the first foul, which I think Barton maybe committed the first foul when he came up and got the guarding position and put the hand on him, you call the first foul, maybe the second foul is not there.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very difficult one for them to see off the monitor and know 100% sure what they're looking at. They've looked at all the angles. You know, do they read the body language of Barton after the play? Just there's so many dynamics that the officials now have to take into consideration on what will be a huge, huge call in this ballgame.
Doug Shiles, Joe Lindsay, Pat Adams, they've had their stay at the monitor. Now it's just a final conversation between them. Offensive foul, and I think that's going to be it, don't you?
I think that's what it is. Brad, I just don't think they could guarantee the contact with Wilbekin on the nose of Barton. They called the common foul to start with. They didn't see anything over there that said you absolutely have to change it, so they go with the common foul.
I think that's good enough for me. Well, but Gett almost comes up with a steal in the corner. Uh-huh.
Maybe that says something right there. The response of Barton. Regardless, 53-49, Tennessee needs a basket.
And there is 1 minute to play. Moore, short on a three. You get, comes right to him on the baseline.
That's not the shot that Tennessee wanted or needed, Brad, from Armani Moore.
Scotty Wilbekin running the show here. There's about a 20-second difference in the shot clock and the game clock. Top-ranked team in the country. Leads by four. Trying to advance to the championship tomorrow on ESPN. Trying to win their 25th straight game to go to 31-2. Wilbekin has a look at the clock, the shot clock. Gets it to Frazier. Back to Wilbekin. Here he comes. Trying to put it up and in. It's short. Tennessee had a hand on it and lost it out of bounds. That might be their last chance. They're going to have to foul now, you would think.
Absolutely. Going to have to foul and make it a two-possession game. And, boy, the great hands of Jarnell Stokes. It wasn't a hand problem. It just goes right between his legs, and he can't get a touch of the basketball because if he touches it, he keeps control of it. And they will go to the monitor to make sure that they have who the ball went off of. The last 2 minutes of regulation, now the last 2 minutes of all overtime period.
It looked like Jarnell just grazed it with his right hand right about there and sent it between his legs. But again, though.
Yeah, who sent it between his legs is the issue. Is it Yeget?
It slipped through Yeget's hands.
Is it
whether Jarnell got his right hand on it or not is the question.
Yeah, because he doesn't touch the basketball. Stokes doesn't from this point forward. And misses his rear end, which is not easy to do, and then he doesn't get a paw on it. But who sent the ball that direction? And
they're going to go with the call they had. I think it's the right call.
I think you have to.
Jarnell just grazed it. And then I thought, tried to think about saving it and decided I'm going to try to pull an acting job here, too, because I'm not sure if I touched it or not. That's just a bang-bang play. Yeah. He did what he could to get his hands on it. And now they're going to have to foul Florida with 20 seconds left.
Try to get a steal right now. Try to get a steal on the inbound.
And they almost did. Very close for Barton.
Brad, now look where the ball. The ball's going to be moved over even deeper into the corner. Come on over. Slide on over. Prather doesn't want to give up the spot, but he's going to have to.
And Billy Donovan's going to take a timeout. This wasn't the greatest inbounds pass in the world, that's for sure. You got to be very careful about who you have handling it down there, whether you have a great inbound passer or not. In that case, Prather's probably done that a lot this year, and he tried to force it to get it to Wilbekin, I think because they know Scotty Wilbekin's the guy who's going to knock down the free throws if he gets fouled.
Right. Again, you close out a ball game, I do, with your five most competitive dudes that you have on the floor, and Wilbekin is that. He's going to fight for his spot and go get his hands on the basketball, but now you've got a deep corner position that is a very, very dangerous spot to inbound the ball. Expect Tennessee to cover up everything with their length. If they can't get the initial steal, they're coming quickly with the harm, and still it's just a two-possession game.
Two-possession game. There's some keys to the game, too, also, that involve technicals that kind of turn things. First, Jaron Maimon bumped Patrick Young. Didn't like the throw-in-the-shoulder call. Told Pat Adams that, and Pat Adams teed him up. That's not only personal foul, but a technical, and that sent him to the bench, and that took away a big part of the inside game for Tennessee. Now they do get it to Wilbekin. 15. Barton's going to have to foul him, and finally does with 14.9.
Really good play by Billy Donovan. He posted Patrick Young up at the elbow. That was the pressure release, because Patrick Young just sealed his guy off like he's calling for a lob play around the rim, but really all he's doing is calling for a lob play to inbounds the basketball, and then he quickly gets it to Wilbekin to close it out.
And this is a guy that's been money from the free throw line in second halves of games and final seconds of games this year for Florida, and it continues. That's his first point of the second half. That might be good enough right there. Two-possession game, no matter if he hits this one or not. And he doesn't. So Tennessee's got to hurry. Martin, a little too slow. Got to get it going. He'll take a long jumper. Short. Young with a rebound. Florida will win. Two more seconds remaining. But they will go to 31-2. And the dream for Jordan McRae and Tennessee of pulling off an upset is about gone.
And as well as Tennessee play, Brad, you're not going to take down the best team in the country on a neutral floor if you lose your discipline two or three times in the game. And Barton lost it on a breakaway with a flagrant one wrap-up. Maimon lost it. They competed their guts out, which you have to do when you take on a team like Florida. But again, four cool seniors, Young, Prather, Yeget, and Wilbekin are going to find themselves in the SEC Finals.
And Pat Young calmly knocks down the free throw. Six-point game. Wildcats of Kentucky itching to get out there. So are the Georgia Bulldogs right behind them in the tunnel. Young got them both. Senior drains two that will end it. Florida has come back from its largest deficit of the year to win. Trailed by seven at halftime. They come back to win by seven in the semifinal, and they go on to the championship. Final score, Florida 56, Tennessee 49. Gators are 31-2. Their 25th straight win sends them to tomorrow's 3:15 championship final on ESPN against either number 2 seed Kentucky or the home team number 3 Georgia. That one's coming up in about 25 minutes on ABC. That's number 446 wins for Billy Donovan. And it was a tough one. And Scotty Wilbekin was the hero of late in the first half and some free throws at the end. He's with Shannon.
Getting a little love from the Gators here, Scotty Wilbekin.